Welcome again to Heartbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown. Everyone has their favorite sad song, but have you ever thought about the sad song as a whole category of music? Well, Adam Brent Houghtaling has, and he set down theories, profiles, and a catalog of songs in the new book, This Will End in Tears, The Miserabilist Guide to Music. And Adam Brent Houghtaling joins us from Brooklyn, New York. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
So why don't you tell us first, what is a miserabilist?
My approach to it was just somebody who kind of enjoys being steeped in a little bit of the dark side of life, a little bit of melancholy, a little gray cloud cover, and somebody who kind of takes some joy from those experiences, like sad songs.
You write in the beginning about how this came up. I guess this came about because you started thinking about the songs that you listen to most or that mean the most to you and realizing that there was a sort of common theme. They were sad.
Yeah, you know, it was, I was just noticing that all the artists that were in my my iPod at the time, they all kind of had this connection to sad material. And the thing that really, I mean, that was the first thing I noticed, but the thing that really kind of drew it, brought it all together and made me think that there was something more there was the fact that they kind of, all these artists kind of crossed a wide range of genres. So John Dowland is in there and Radiohead is in there. And that was kind of really interesting to me. So that's kind of what really drew me towards thinking about making it a book.
You talk in the book about the difference between depression and melancholy. Explain that for us.
Obviously, depression is something that, you know, that is considered a disease. And melancholy, you know, I think it is something that's more, it's kind of a prolonged state of rumination. It's not necessarily depression. It's something less than depression and more than a bad mood.
But how does that play into music? When you think about sad songs, where are they coming from? What's the impetus for them?
One thing that kind of tied a lot of the artists together was kind of a streak of either melancholy or just outright depression. And that's one of the reasons why I bother to talk about depression in the book, because I wanted to treat it with some sense of gravity. A lot of the artists were, you know, unfortunately took their own lives and dealt with a lot of dark stuff. There's always historically been this, you know, popularly held notion that being melancholic or depressive leads to some kind of creative genius. And actually a really good example of that is Bruce Springsteen's recent revelation that he went through a period of depression in the early 80s where he was nearly suicidal. And from that came Nebraska, which is about as dark an album I think he'll ever make. So there does seem to be some kind of connection there.
Another thing that you look at here is the science, you know, the sort of emerging science of the brain, about what attracts us to music, where music comes from. So what did you learn about, or what struck you about the science of sadness, or the science of sad music, if you will?
Emotionally charged music in general tends to affect us in rather profound ways, very similar to, you know, sex and drugs and chocolate cake. It kind of lights up our reward center. And sad music is very emotionally charged. And I think one thing that I, you know, I hadn't really thought of before, but, you know, I think is very interesting is, and this is specifically about sad music as opposed to other music, is there really is this intimate connection with it. You know, you're not listening to it when you're at the beach with your friends or during a dinner party. You're usually alone. And I think that creates something really personal. And also, you know, another thing that I've been thinking about is how you really are able to put yourself into these, in you know, into sad music, specifically into, you know, narrative forms of sad music, just like you're able to root yourself into a novel. you kind of fill in the gaps with your own heartbreaks and your own miseries. And I think that makes the connection really personal.
All right, so give us some examples, maybe some two or three of your favorite sad songs of all time.
Oh, my favorites? You know, I'm a really big fan of Lush Life, which I write a song essay about that in the book. I think the poetry is just amazing in it. And, you know, I love the version from John Coltrane and Johnny Hartman. I'm a big fan of both of them. And I love, there's a song called Our Song by Joe Henry that just, the first time I heard it, it just leveled me. I was in tears.
Does that happen to you a lot, Adam?
Crying?
Yeah, listening to music and crying.
You know, it happens every once in a while, sure. I would probably guess more than the average music fan, just because I am drawn to this music and I do connect with it so personally. So, yeah, it happens.
Well, you end the book with a list. You know, we all love lists. The 100 saddest songs, the 100 saddest songs you end the book with.
Yeah.
I don't want to give away the list here, but number one is Samuel Barber's Adagio for Strings, so a lot of people know that. But was that hard to put together a list?
Absolutely. You know, I labored over, there's a lot of playlists in the book. There are playlists after every essay. There are playlists after most of the artist profiles. And then there's the top 100 list at the end. And I labored over every single list. And, you know, I could easily spend an hour asking myself, you know, is this song number 10 or number 8? I don't know. And, you know, choosing Adagio for Strings, that would probably be, no matter how many times I went back to the list, that would probably end up at the top. Because not only is it a beautiful piece of music, there's a lot of historical aspects of the song. There's a lot of, you know, I did straw polls. I did a lot of just collecting other polls and other opinions that I found across the internet and in other books and media. So I tried to bring all of this stuff along with my own personal opinions about the songs together to kind of weigh exactly where they fall in the list. But yeah, all the lists were definitely laborious labors of love. So,
and just before I let you go, just so I'm clear, do you also listen to upbeat, happy music as well? Or is this it?
No, you know what? My favorite forms of music are sad music and like really saccharine bubblegum 60s pop and, you know, the Monkees.
I knew you had that side to you.
Absolutely. The Monkees, the Archies, you know, the list goes on and on. But it's really interesting that those are the two that it's almost like a manic depressive aspect of listening to music or approach to music in a way.
Okay, well, this book about sad songs is titled This Will End in Tears. Adam Brent Houghtaling, nice to talk to you.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for joining us again on Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown.